Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this February 20th, 2017 regularly scheduled Midland Public School Board of Education meeting. At this time, I'd appreciate it if everyone would turn off their cell phones. Cell phones interfere with our TV feed. So I'd appreciate it if you do that. And then if you would all stand and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Scott, if you could call the roll, please.
Absolutely. President Brandstatt.
Here.
Vice President Singer.
Here.
Treasurer Frazee.
Here.
Member Baker. Here. Member Blasey.
Here.
Member Friedel.
Here.
Excellent. All right, thank you very much. Moving into item 2.0, the consent agenda. 2.1, approval of the minutes from our January 16th organizational and regular meetings. 2.2, person recommended for employment, art teacher. 2.3, Mr. Chris Sabrin is resigning his administrative position as media instructional technology specialist and requests to be reassigned as a teacher with the Midland Public Schools for the 2017-18 school year. 2.4 is staff members who have announced their resignation with the effective dates noted. 2.5 is approval of the payment of the school system's bills for the months of December 2016 and January 2017. 2.6 is legal invoices for payment. At this time, I'll entertain a motion.
I move to approve items 2.1 through 2.6 on the consent agenda.
Support.
Moved by Pam, supported by Scott. Is there any discussion?
I have a point of discussion.
All right.
At the January 16th Board of Education meeting, the groups of construction contracts slated for award, 411, 412, and 413 were introduced. After the approval of 411, during the discussion period for 412 and 413, Mr. Charo stated that we awarded the bids to the low bidder in all cases. We did award to the lowest bidder in the general trades category of 413 by awarding to two different contractors. The balance of the awards were the cumulative low bidders by combining bids together for the two schools. I did not participate in these bids as a contractor, so my interest in voicing this clarification is based solely on my fiscal responsibility as a board member, as well as protecting the buying power of the Midland Public Schools for our future contracts. The contracting community is well accustomed to the investment of bidding multiple projects with a percentage of success. But the criteria deciding that percentage, especially with tax dollars, must be transparent. With all the upcoming work, we must have the support of our local contracting community to ensure that we're getting the lowest prices from the most qualified contractors, so I feel the clarification is warranted.
All right, thank you. Are there any other discussion
Yes,
points?
I wanted to say thank you, our congratulations to Mr. Sabrin. I'm sure there's many students that are excited to see him back in the classroom. So congratulations.
Thanks, Chris.
Yeah, thanks. Thank you. Any other points of discussion? All right. At this time, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? All right, our consent agenda passes. Moving on to item 3.0, Board of Education Matters, presentations to the board. Mike, we have our February shining stars.
Correct. We have Ms. Corbin, Danielle Corbin would like to come up. And I'll read a little bit by Danielle as she's coming up. Ms. Corbin began her employment with Midland Public Schools in 2006 as a substitute bus driver with the Transportation Department. In 2007, her assignment changed to that of a regular bus driver with the vital role of getting Midland Public Schools students to and from school every day. Before coming to MPS, Ms. Corbin was a bus aide for several years with Genesee Intermediate School District. Danielle was nominated for the Shining Star by two MPS elementary students. And they're the best comments when you get them from students. Among their comments were the following. Mrs. Coco, is that correct? is really nice and takes care of us like her own kids on the bus. Every morning she says, good morning, when we get on the bus. Then when we get to school, she says, have a great day. Mrs. Coco is very easy to talk with and very friendly. On snowy days, she drives very carefully and slowly. We can always depend on her to get us to school safely every day. Congratulations, Danielle.
Thank you. I love those kids' comments.
Yes.
Wonderful.
Thank you.
And our second shining star, if Linda McDonald would come forward. And I'll read a little bit about Linda. Ms. McDonald joined the Midland Public Schools staff in 1988 as a special education teacher at Chestnut Hill Elementary. During her years with MPS, in addition to teaching at Chestnut Hill, Linda has taught special education at Adams and Plymouth. And this year, Linda shares her day with students and staff at Plymouth and Seaburg. Linda earned her bachelor's degree from Michigan State University in 1979 and her master's degree from Central Michigan University in 1984. Linda was nominated for the Shining Star by a coworker and students. We have some more student comments. Among their comments were the following. I think Mrs. McDonald should get a Shining Star because she is very nice and gives multiple chances. She should be a Shining Star because she shows empathy. She is kind because she helps you if you are stuck on a problem. And she is caring because when you make mistakes, she forgives you. She works really hard every day. She makes math very, very fun. Whenever there is a hard problem, she always makes it easier. She is a very lighthearted person. She is super nice. Another reason is she has a passion for what she does. No complaints, just actions. The lady really deserves a Shining Star. And that was the kids. For me, Linda is a wonderful team partner. She is very organized, enthusiastic, positive, and knowledgeable. She is very caring towards all of our students and has a great listening ear. Her soft voice and her caring ways make all of our students feel at ease and comfortable. Linda freely shares resources with me, and on our team, we are appreciative of everything she does. Linda is a humble person, so you would never hear her toot her own horn, so I'm tooting it for her. Congratulations, Linda.
Linda.
Thank you.
All right, moving into 3.2, which is student leadership at Seaburg. Paul, Mr. Schwoll.
Mic check. Great. Good evening, board and families and friends. One of the pillars for the PYP framework that we've been working on at Seaburg is taking action. And so I have some Bulldogs with me tonight, and it's a great pack that we have there. It's a great day to be a Bulldog. And so I'll be introducing a few of those in just a few moments, but I'll let maybe some of the student leadership advisorship speak a little bit, and then I'll introduce the students.
I'm Melissa Grunder. I teach third grade at Seaburg, and we wanted to talk to you guys about action today because with that being one of the essential elements of the primary years program, and we're looking at authorization this spring, it's really been a focus for us all year, both on a small scale and a larger scale. And on a small scale, it's really how the kids are taking what they're learning in the classroom and putting it elsewhere. It's what they're doing with their learning, and we're seeing that every day. But on a larger scale, we also want the kids to realize that they're impacting a global community, and they can have a positive impact on our world. And so as the student leadership team, we've been working on some bigger projects this year, And that's what we want to share with you today. I could talk a lot about action, but I thought it would be more impactful coming from the children. So we talked to some of the kids, and these were some of the things that they said action was. So Audra, third grader, she's right here. She said, when you're acting, you see a problem, and instead of leaving it for someone else, you go out of your way to fix it. Ryan, another third grader, said it's doing the right thing for people. Charlie, a first grader, said going home to learn more about what interested you in school. And Gavin, a first grader, said action is being kind to one another and taking care of the world by picking up litter. And Davis, a fifth grader, she's also right here, she said action is taking charge in situations big or small to make a change. So I'm going to leave that.
I'm Kayla Lanfear. I'm a first grade teacher at Siebert. To follow up Melissa, she said that there's many ways the students are taking action in small ways in their classrooms on the daily basis, but we wanted to outline for you some of the ways in which they've taken larger action. We're going to let the student leadership members talk more in depth about each of these, but a brief overview of some of the ways that Siebert students have taken action reaching out to the community include our Nonviolence Week in the end of October. Then we wrote letters for Veterans Day, which we then mailed to a Midland service member, and one of our members here will talk more about that. The members of Mrs. Grunder's third grade class and also a first grader took on Adopt a Family, and then the first grader was Jack, who took it on as Jack's Toy Drive to help even get the word out more. Currently, we are working on a fundraiser called Pennies for Patients or Pasta for Pennies, in which we're raising money for childhood cancer victims. And during Valentine's Day, I think in lieu of a Valentine's party, a fifth grade team decided to make blankets for Project Linus. And currently we have a jump rope team which is going around the community showing off their skills. So we will let our student members here talk more in depth about each of these.
So I'm supposed to introduce them. Yes, so our Nonviolence Week will be addressed by Gretchen Shope.
Hi, my name is Gretchen Shope. I'm in the fifth grade and my teacher is Mrs. Pellet. I was asked to go to an assembly about nonviolence in the beginning of the year. When me and several others went, we found ourselves learning many different things that include bullying, friendship, and cyberbullying. When it was all done, our group decided to plan out a week of nonviolence for our school. We ordered bracelets, had a donut bully day, and just had a really fun week of nonviolence. I feel that this was a really good way to stop bullying and influence kindness. I also feel that this was an awesome way to get kids to make more friends and experience new things. And we have some leftover bracelets from the Nonviolence Week that we would like to hand out to you.
Excellent.
Good job, Ellie. And now, Ellie Sankowski
will
speak about our Veterans Day letters.
I'm Ellie Sankowski, and I'm in the fifth grade at Ms. Eckers' class. Siebert student leadership make cards for veterans. It's important for people to realize everything they've done for our country, and to support them and to let them know that we care about what they've done for us.
Next up was our Adopt a Family. And Audra Segura is going to come and talk to us about that.
Hello, my name is Audra Segura, and I am in third grade at Siebert. Before winter break, my teacher, Mrs. Grunder, asked what we could do to take action. After quite a few crazy ideas, she took some practical ones and put them together. Mrs. Grunder then made a sign-up sheet for parents who wanted to participate in getting the toys for a family. After a few weeks, we wrapped the presents, and soon after that, the baby sister and their father came to pick up the presents. The sad thing was that I wasn't there, but I can imagine their faces when they saw all the beautiful presents we got for them.
Thank you, Audra. And then just a footnote, the upper right, Jack's toy drive. Jack walked into my office and said, Mr. Schroll, I'd like to do a toy drive for all the kids who don't get toys at Christmas. And so we collected several dozen toys and sent those off to a local Toys for Tots. Now we move on to our Pennies for Patients, or Pasta for Pennies. And Davis Blythe is going to come to talk with us.
Hi, my name is Davis Fife. I'm a fifth grader at Seabird Elementary, and my teacher is Mrs. Morton. Today I'm talking about our Pennies for Pasta fundraiser. We are raising money for the Lymphoma and Leukemia Society. Our goal is for each student to bring in at least $1. The class that brings in the most money will get a catered lunch from Olive Garden. This is important because blood cancer like this has affected many families. People have had an extremely rough time dealing with the outcome. I myself had a very rough time dealing with the loss of my dad to these two types of cancers. It is very important to me that other families do not experience this, especially with their children. The money will go to paying for things like medicine and research and to help the patients. If you would like to donate, we will leave a box over there. We are collecting through February 24th.
Thank you, Davis. And now our Valentine's Day project, Project Linus, and Ellie will come back and talk about that.
My fifth grade class made blankets for people in need. Some parents donated some money to help pay for the cost of the fleece blankets. Then everyone in my class made tie blankets. Then we donated the blankets to Project Line. Project Line is where kids who were having a hard time at home can cuddle with their blankets and know that people care and love them. When doing the blankets, I knew that I was helping someone and giving them comfort.
Thank you, Ellie. And now, Jump Rope Team, a great way to build team spirit and community. And here to talk about that is Thomas Thaxter.
Hi, I'm Thomas Thaxter. I'm in fifth grade, and my teacher is Mrs. Pellet. When I heard about the jump rope team, I wanted to try it. My jump rope teacher, Mrs. Sugnett, showed us lots of cool tricks and routines. We had to practice a lot every day and get up very early every day. The jump rope team is very active and gets kids in really good shape. It's very fun, and it helps build our Seabird community.
Very proud of our Bulldog Pack, and these students are just sampling. They were the brave ones that could come and speak tonight, and I just want to recognize them for that. And if you have some questions, I'll bring them back up, and you can ask a question or two.
Thank you.
Right after Katie speaks about the last slide.
Oh, okay.
All right. I'm Katie Morton. I'm a fifth grade teacher at Seabird. And these are all examples of ways that we have or are currently taking action, but we also have some planned for the upcoming months of the school year. So as far as community involvement, we are partnering with the Seabird PTO and working on a March's Reading Month, planning some activities in the school for that. We are also looking forward to doing something special. It's in the works right now for Earth Day, some kind of cleanup around Seabird. And then we're also looking at doing letters to veterans again around Memorial Day, kind of as our last event school-wide. And then also in the classroom, we see action every day. We see our kids making those connections, going home and coming back and talking about it, typically being pretty excited. So we know that it's going on in the classrooms, but we also have some efforts that are being brought up from parents, such as the Scrub Club, which we'll be focusing on hand washing and staying healthy that way, which is pretty important this time of year.
Right.
And so those are just ways that in the classroom we will have action going on as well. So now, if there are any questions.
Thank you. So who has the first question?
I don't have a question, but I just want to say how impressed I am on your leadership to come here and share what you're doing, the action that you're participating in at Seabird. My kids are a lot older, and I remember our PTO running a lot of these activities. But to have the students run the activities, come up with the ideas, and help follow through, is phenomenal, and how much you're each making a huge impact, not only on your school and the community, but your reach is so much greater. And I can just imagine the kids either receiving the blanket or any, watching the jump ropers jump, that you're making an impact and you're bringing happiness and care to people. So I want to commend you for what you're doing. And thank you for being brave and coming here and speaking to us all.
I don't have a question either. I just wanted to say you guys did an awesome job. When you were talking about the different activities that you're doing, I got goosebumps, and that's a good thing. The other thing, Davis, which one's Davis? Man, you gotta be a debater. You can talk so fast. Remember that. Dow High debate team, they could use you. That's awesome.
I think we should commend Mr. Schroll and the staff for just doing a phenomenal job in creating a tremendous pack of Bulldogs with excellent leadership skills. And then to the students, could any of you share with us where you come up with these ideas on how to create these projects? Your social and world awareness is phenomenal. Keep it up, please.
Yes,
wonderful. So important. Thank you. So do you know who's winning your penny contest yet?
I think it's our class.
$400
already. Wow. Less than 2 weeks, we've already raised like $400.
Wow. Who's in second place?
I have no idea.
Scott. Excellent. So once you go on to middle school, because a lot of you were fifth graders, are you hoping to continue this type of activity? I know once you go on, you'll have a lot of other new opportunities and take some of what you learned and continue. Excellent.
Even the non-fifth graders, moving on, are you going to continue in the next grade with these projects? Good job.
All right. Excellent. Thank you all so much for coming out tonight. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Nice job, everyone.
Amazing how much is going on in our district. All right, moving on to item four, which is Board of Education Matters 4.1 bid package. Will that go to you, Mike?
It can.
Okay.
Either one of us, Bob. Do you want it or no?
Either way.
Okay.
Okay.
We have the bid package for the Central Auditorium flooring. If you recall last time, we pulled that off,
yes.
And we were able to get several bidders this time, and we are awarding to the low bidder on floor covering ink of Clinton Township, Michigan for $144,400. So we're looking for your approval on that.
All right. Do I have a?
I have a motion to accept item 4.1, bid package number 16.
Support.
Moved by Pam, supported by Scott. Is there any discussion? I do know Daryl went out, and is he still here? You really went out and did a good job on this one, did a good sell job to get those bids to come in. So we really appreciate all the work you put into this one. All right, any other comments?
I had one. Daryl, I know you had to work hard at this because of kind of where it fell in the whole spectrum of the bids coming out. And we have some major packages out right now. Have you gotten any initial feedback about how our coverage will be? No, on the project that are out right now for our secure entrances, because I know this is one particular one that you had a little bit of trouble with.
Yeah, so we've got 72 bidders that have picked up on that one, and there's four categories. So as of right now, we've got good coverage in all categories. We're still tracking some of them because we're a little later in the season. But, you know, usually around first addendum, we'll have a good idea of who intends on bidding. But as of right now, we do have coverage in all categories.
Great.
All right, thank you. All right, if No more discussion at this time. All in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? All right. Moving into 4.2. Who wants to?
Want me to take the there?
Take grab this one and explain to those who have been tracking this one.
Do the best I can. It's been around for a long time. We've been a plaintiff in a lawsuit, commonly known as a Dare versus State of Michigan. Didn't know this till we started talking about leaving. We actually joined the lawsuit in 1998, and it took a board resolution to get into it, and it kind of takes a board resolution to get out of it. It's basically one of the ones along the state's lines of unfunded mandates, and it has to do with having to provide data to the CEPI, which is a state organization. And the claim was they required data, it required effort on the part of the district, and they weren't giving us any funds to do that. It was additional that came along. The court, the case itself has been kind of mired because in this case in particular, unlike previous cases, they did partially fund it. So there is money being given to us for data. It's just not fully funded. And so the case has revolved for the last few years around you have to be able to prove how much money you're out. In other words, if they're not funding it fully, what's fully mean and what's it cost? But you can imagine that's not an easy thing, and that comes back on the plaintiffs to prove that. Things that Mike's attended and things that we've talked to and read with the lawyer, more and more districts have opted out. And of course, every time they opt out, then the cost to the remaining districts go up. It's not outrageous, but I would tell you over quarterly, it can be anywhere from $500 to $1,000 to $1,500, depending on what they've done during that quarter towards the lawsuit. But here we are, 18, 19 years in, and we just don't see and we don't hear anything out there like this case is going to be winnable or winnable soon, or if a settlement's really going to amount to continuing on. So after Mike talked to people that he knows, the other superintendents, myself, we really think it's time to remove ourselves from the lawsuit. But it does take a resolution, just like it took a resolution to get in.
When they have had some wins, the state has been bright enough to realize that you just take school aid fund and earmark it in a different way, and you've met some obligation there. So really, you're not going to see additional funds of any capacity staying in at this point. So it's time to get out. The bill gets larger and larger each time, mm-hmm. with fewer and fewer districts in it. You're not going to see relief from it. So.
I just want to make sure I understood this. So it's costing us up to $6,000 a year to remain in this plaintiff class?
It would depend on the year, how many plaintiffs are still in, and just like a lawyer would, bills based on what they've done that time. So it depends on the activity during that that quarter.
Yeah, that may be a tad high, but,
up to.
That could be anywhere in the middle.
Yeah, sure.
Something like that would be.
Okay, thanks.
Yep.
Do we have a wording on the resolution itself?
Correct. Yeah,
the resolution is included in the board packet. So the word we did that just the same way. We went to our attorney, and in essence, it's.
You don't need to read the full resolution. You can approve it and say the resolution is on file here if someone would like to read that resolution.
And it just says that we want to withdraw as a plaintiff effective immediately. We know we'll have some cost left because you can't just pull it in the middle. There's a certain amount of time that we got a little bit of cost left. So that's the general part.
All right. Do I have a motion?
I'll move that we approve item 4.2 as stated in the minutes and discussed here today.
I have support.
Support.
All right. Moved by Scott, supported by Mary. Is there any other discussion this time? All right. This time, all those in favor, say aye.
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 All those opposed? Moving on to item 5, which is request to address the board. I have one person listed here, Mark.
Got to raise a little higher than the kids here. good evening, I'm Mark Hackbarth, Midland City Education Association president and teacher at Jefferson Middle School. First of all, I'd like to start by wishing you a belated school board appreciation month. I figured why stop at January, we can, but anyways, the reason I'm here is at our last Association Board of Directors meeting, we approved making a donation to the Central Park Elementary School playground in honor of the MPS school board.
Oh,
and on the wall, there'll be an inscription that says, in appreciation of the MPS school board for all that it does for our schools, our students, and our community. So we discussed various ways of showing our appreciation, but we felt this was appropriate with the new school and a long-lasting way to do it as well. So
nice.
To sum up, thank you for all you do for our community. The countless hours you put in, it does make a difference. So thank you.
Thank you, Mark, so much. We really appreciate that as a board. We look forward to that. So we actually were over at Central Park today before the board meeting, touring it. It's coming along very nicely, and that type of appreciation is very much appreciated. How many times can I say the word appreciated? So, thanks, Mark. All right, moving into, is there anybody else at this time who would like to address the board? All right, moving into item 6.0, which is finance, facilities, and operations. So we did have an FFO study committee meeting last Monday. So yep. Patrick, if you would be so kind to read the minutes.
Yes, February 13th, 2017, Angela, myself, Pam, Mr. Cheryl, Mr. Cooper, we're all there. And then as well, Daryl and Dale from French Associates. We had a bond update and a financials update. At the bond front, Mr. Jerome of French Associates presented an overview of the secure entry plans for each of the schools in the district. He also reviewed exterior finishes, including staining and metal siding at Central Auditorium. Question. Mr. Dumbrell of Barton Mallow provided a construction update to the committee. He reviewed the status of the various projects, including an update of flooring bids for the auditorium. As far as financials go, Mr. Cooper and the committee reviewed the January financial reports. Additional topics discussed by the committee were the upcoming March budget adjustment, Chartwell's food service contract renewal, the OPAA employee group, and a resolution to remove the MPS from the Adair versus State of Michigan lawsuit. School properties were reviewed along with requests regarding a Miracle League baseball field. Next meeting is scheduled for Monday, March 13th at 5 o'clock.
All right, thank you very much. 6.2.
I have for you tonight gifts totaling $19,339.08. Just for information, but they're a wide range, which you can see there in your board packet and also at the end of the board meeting. But you'll notice we have our usual booster club, like at Northeast, and Woodcrest PTO, a very nice one from St. John's Episcopal Church for elementary classroom level books. If I'm not mistaken, that was to all the new teachers. If you remember, we hired quite a few, and they we're putting together leveled packets for each of those, which I thought was very nice. Our teachers took some initiative, and you'll see the target field trips that came from groups of teachers that wanted to go on field trips, and they found that as a source and got approved for a couple there. The usual sports boosters clubs there doing a nice job giving to lots of different programs you'll see going down. And then there's basically two different ways that the Midland Area Community Foundation has been at work here. You'll see the first one is some of the normal things they do, like the nonviolence, the snow sculpture, and then of course they hold the East Lawn student as an endowment fund that they use some for workshop. And then you'll see another one, again, teacher initiated, where they were going through the Youth Action Council, the Kellogg Youth Fund, and they were putting in for, as you'll see there, things that deal with the students directly in the classroom. So they were asking for money for listening stations, CDs, project-based learning curriculum, field trips, etc. So once again, very generous. This time it's just for informational. There's none there that you have to approve.
All right, thank you. And thanks to everybody in the community who so generously, month after month, supports our school district. We really appreciate it. All right, moving into item 7, human resources. There was a committee meeting, so Scott?
There was indeed. On February 1st at 1:30 p.m., a number of items were discussed. We received updates on the status of an MCEA grievance. Ms. Marchese informed the committee of a court dismissal of a suit that was pending against the district. We discussed the 2016-17 internal full-time equivalent staffing report, which was reviewed. This document reflects the staffing levels for the current school year and the previous four school years. Overall, The district is down approximately 6 total FTEs from the 2015-16 school year. We discussed issues with staffing and board policies. Our next meeting is April 12th, 2017 at 1:30 p.m.
Thank you very much. 7.2, would you like to take this one?
I'd like to recognize a staff member that has passed away, a former staff member. Board and staff extend their deepest sympathy to the family of Mrs. Alice Sias, who passed away on February 8th. Sias was a librarian, media center specialist at Jefferson Central, Chippewassee, Wendover, and Mills. Mrs. Sias was an MPS staff member for 33 years, retiring in 1997.
Thanks. Thoughts to her family. All right, 7.3, following, or do you guys want to do this, or do you want me to?
You can take it if you want.
All right. Do you want me to read them all?
You're the president. You can take it.
Okay.
I always recognize
them. Okay, so I will read off the following staff members who have announced their retirement with the effective dates: Susan Arndt, Rebecca Faust, Sherry Goff, Mike Jarma, Mary Keegstra, Julie McDonald, Susan Ostahowski, Candace Pritchett, Ruth Sell, Mary Ellen Trombley, and Connie Wan. So we appreciate all their many years of service. Wish them well when they retire. All right, 8, correspondence to and from the Board of Education. You can read that in the agenda. 9, scheduled activities for information. So our next regularly scheduled board meeting will be March 20th. And moving into study discussion session. So we'll start with Brad tonight, because I think Patrick put in a special request that he not go first. So. I'll keep that in mind, Brad. Don't worry.
Okay. Thanks.
I just had a great time touring the school today. It's what I do every day, is going through construction sites and being involved in construction, and it's great to see how different a school environment that is. It's like nothing I've been in before, and I've been through many schools throughout the state of Michigan, and it's really exciting.
I agree. That was a wonderful tour. Thank you for that. There's a couple things that I'm looking forward to. One is, I read about the kindergarten orientation, and I want to give kudos to Mr. Sherrow on really taking an effort to identify students earlier and give us all a better understanding of what to expect and to plan, and I think that's just gonna be better for the district overall, so thank you for that. We also learned over the last week about the governor's budget proposal, and I was happy to see that 38 at-risk funding he has in his budget plan would follow the at-risk student, and we have all been rallying for that. Yes. For years. And I certainly hope that makes it through and we can see that to fruition. I think we all believe that the funds should follow the kid no matter what their zip code is. And I also saw in his budget proposal that $50 more would go to high school students. So I thought that was appropriate too. We all know that it costs more to teach high school students, so that makes a lot of sense. The Michigan Department of Education Accountability Scorecard came out, and Midland High went to a reward school, and big kudos to Midland High for that. That's quite an achievement in closing the gap, so a lot of things to celebrate. We all went through superintendent evaluation training, and I think going through that training, we really realize all the different jobs that our superintendent does for us, and many different categories that we evaluate on. So it just was a moment of appreciation coming from that meeting as well. And then just a reminder to everyone about the Booster Bash, March 24th. It's a fun event. It's a great way to raise funds to help support our athletics in both sides of the community.
Did I see a different location change this year?
Yeah, I was going to point that out because I almost didn't catch that. Yeah, so it's at the Great Hall this year, not at Dow Diamond.
Oh.
Yes. I know, I would have shown up and no one would have been there.
I would have been, right. No athletes clapping. That's all I have.
All right.
Just a couple things. I, with regard to the evaluation training, I really did appreciate that. It was eye-opening, I think, really, to say the least, and it gave me a great insight, Mike, into what you do on what we have to look at and what you do on a daily basis, weekly, monthly, quarterly. There's a lot of behind-the-scenes work that you put in toward making our district incredible, and so it just made me appreciate that a lot more. So that was a really good thing. I was proud of Siebert tonight, near and dear to my heart for obvious reasons. So just congratulations again to that group of future leaders. And finally, to all of the students who wrote me these cool cards, personalized, just want to say thank you very much. So that was fantastic to walk into these tonight and see these on our desk.
Those cards are from Julie Hyatt's class over at Carpenter, and then the green cards are from Siebert as well. So recognition to both of them.
Yes, thank you.
Fabulous.
All right. I took a few notes tonight from the student letters for the Shining Stars, and then listening to students talk. You know, I noticed empathy, kind, caring, forgiveness, passion, safety, friendly, soft, comforting voice, students needing love. And you hear those things said, and it makes you realize that both the parents and teachers in this district are doing a wonderful job. The fact that students are looking for that and acknowledging that makes me proud to be up here, proud that my kids go to school in a district like this, in a community like this. And the second one, I noticed this is a bit self-serving, but Mrs. Faust is retiring at Chestnut Hill. I've had a student in her class the last 3 years in a row as a kindergarten teacher. I'm hoping it wasn't my kids that drove her to retirement. But I wanted to thank her for all her service and time, and she's been a big part of our life here for 3 years now. That's it.
I wanted to express thanks for all the people in the community again that have made donations, and a special thanks to those teachers who took the initiative to go out for scholarships from Target for field trips, because money's tight, and that's, you know, when teachers go the extra mile, which they always do, to do things like that, that's awesome. And I also want to thank the kids that made these awesome cards. Wonderful artwork and great messages, so thanks. It's nice to be appreciated. And also by the board, union student or teacher union, recognizing the school board's work. And the training that we went through for the superintendent's evaluation. Superintendents have to be evaluated every year like teachers. So it is truly amazing all the work that you have to go through, and his evaluation is dependent on how well our students do. The bottom line is it's all about the kids and how well the kids do, and so that was nice to see that connection as well.
All right, I guess I just had a couple other things. One, since our last board meeting, we had Run Fair, which is Dow High's performance. You know, in the fall we get to go to Rhapsody at Midland High, and in the winter we get to go to Run Fair at Dow High. So once again, a just incredible display of talent of our students, and even a cameo from a retired teacher. So wonderful evening. Groosticker applications are out. We like to, you know, recognize people on a monthly basis, but also please take the opportunity, students, other teachers, parents, if you have a teacher in the district that you would like to recognize with a Gerstacker Award, please take the time to write an application out. You can find that information on our website, who to submit that to. Letters, any type of letter is great. I was on the committee a couple years ago, and it's so heartwarming to read all the stories about everything that our teachers do for our students. So please take the time to write those letters in for us. School of Choice applications, I think, are still online. I had someone actually contact me the other day about how to go about doing that, so I want to point out that that is something that you can find on our website. And congratulations, too, to the two shining stars tonight. It was interesting that we had a bus driver, because recently I realized I leave for work so early in the morning, and I actually have two buses that I always pass on my way, and I'm thinking they have been out a lot longer than I have even, because they've already been to the bus garage, made sure the bus was okay, started it up, and made it all the way out to my, you know, neighborhood. So much appreciation for bus drivers that start early and end late. And with that, I'll turn it over to you, Mike.
I wrote to you a little while back about positive alternatives to school suspension. Mm-hmm. So we got that program up and going in the middle schools. We chose middle schools as our target group at this point in time. We're partnering with the Community and Mental Health Partners and The Rock. Penny Miller-Nelson has kind of been our lead person with the community groups. Tila Sherman and Keith Seibert are APs at Northeast Jefferson. Have done an outstanding job in this program going. It's in the early stages. We're learning stuff from it. A lot of promise there, and we'll track data and see our progress as we go. So it's fun, at least to the end of the year. We've gotten some grant funding. If we get good data, maybe we continue to get funding for that. But certainly better than sending them home for nothing, and they're getting the opportunity to rethink their thinking. They got them into those behavior issues. Mm-hmm. While continuing their schooling as well. So real good program this time. That same group, we've been working with the community mental health group on getting mental health services into the schools for our students, as well as training staff on mental health issues and how do we help assist with that. So far they've trained our JCC teachers, school psychs, social workers, and now they're moving on to classroom teachers themselves. At some point, we may even do support staff. And so a lot of this has been done through mental health agencies, but as well through many private partners who are doing this on their own dime. So we have a lot to be appreciative there as well. You know, I see a lot of social issues that everybody wants us to address in schools, from heroin epidemic to bullying to those type of things, and my answer to that is, you know, I can't do every individual issue, because truth, the problem is bigger than that, and to me it really comes down to mental health, violence, to all those pieces that if we can work on that side of it, we're going to make great gains. And some of the things that Petra mentioned about some of the comments that our kids are using with empathy and those type of words is really the route that I'm pushing for us to go to help with all those issues more systematically going forward. I think Pam mentioned the governor's state of the dress. Pretty good news to start with. We got a long route to go. We get the House version, get the Senate's version, get the arm wrestling going on somewhere, usually around June 1st, much sooner than we have had in the past. We'll get a budget. And the at-risk funds is one of the most exciting things I could think of happening to MPS. If you think about the one category that we really probably the only category that you could really fall and say MPS has still got to grow on is our achievement gap, because we have such high learners, but we have lower learners as well, that at-risk group. And if we get the dollars that they're saying about, the power to change those kids' future, which will change our county and our community, could be really powerful going forward. So we're really excited about those dollars. Keep pushing your legislators. Our local legislators have listened pretty good on that one, and so let's keep pushing on that one, because I think it's really important for us going forward, and there's a lot of power there. Our last PIC meeting in January, I was actually away at a conference getting training, so Mr. Bruton and Mr. Cooper stepped in for me, and they did Project Lead the Way training, and I believe a couple of you were there that day, and I understand it was quite exciting, so that fits into Central Park, and then certainly the other elementary schools as we go forward. Recognition to Chelsea, and help me, Brian, make sure I say your name. Sylvie, I was going to say it wrong, so thank you. Kindergarten teacher at Carpenter, I guess her and her kids did an outstanding job there, and you got to see kindergarten students with Project Lead Way, which is pretty promising. Mark Neff, your fifth grade teacher from Plymouth, who's going to be our instructional technology person at Central Park to get that up and rolling, also did a good job, and they were showing you sensors and bumpers and switches and robots going forward. So some really neat curriculum stuff in there. And by the way, CIA got to see some of that equipment over at Michigan STEM Center today as well. So some pretty neat stuff going on there. So I want to mention that. Pam mentioned the accountability scorecard on there, and again, you know, we score with the higher scoring districts where we've always scored with almost every one of the indicators. Brian will spend more time going into that in detail with CIA and pass some of that on, but you know, data can get quite deep and boring. But the one thing that it does point out for us is our achievement gap, but make sure you understand almost every high performing school district like ours is struggling with the achievement gap. For the first time, you've had to look at your bottom, and when you have really high flyers, your gap between is quite high. Doesn't mean we don't need to fix it. We do need to fix it. But and so a lot of intervention strategies need to be put in place that are targeted and specific to the weaknesses of those kids. Hence, some at-risk dollars would be very nice to have in order to do that. Woodcrest. So if you recall, we're going to graduate a three-section fifth grade. All of the other grades at Woodcrest are now four sections. And so we needed to try to hold to a three-section kindergarten because of just physical classrooms at that building. So we thought we could, looking at all the data from the past and looking ahead. We've been looking at this for over a year by just saying we probably won't be able to allow school choice in. Well, our kindergarten roundup, which went very well, and I'll give a lot of credit to the principals for organizing that, show that our residents at Woodcrest number is so high, we might not be able to hold the three sections already. So hence, we need to look at a short-term solution in the building. So under construction next year, what was going to become our STEM makerspace for 1 year doesn't get touched until the following year of construction, because that's a year and a half project. Mm-hmm. We'll be able to use that with some walls put in there as our extra classroom for a year. The long term, we're getting pricings, and then we're going to look at suggestions to build one or two classrooms onto the new construction at Woodcrest. And we won't have to fight what's going on to the north there unless it continues to grow beyond that. And that's a whole another issue where we might have to look at redrawing lines. So we have fought the request for Woodcrest for quite a while, that growth out there, so to the north. That should solve that one. We still have Siebert to look at a little bit because of its enrollment trend as well. Our schools to the north, that growth to the north of 10 is affecting our schools to the north. So we may have to do some rezoning down the road anyway. But we have a solution for short-term solution. We'll bring you possibly a long-term solution to look at going forward. We had a passenger van donated, and so we had the golf coach at Midland High, and Bob will probably bring that to you next month. I'm actually in the donation period, but I wanted to give you a heads up. So he purchased a van for he really wanted to use it for the Midland High golf team, small teams that sometimes we have them rent vans or parents transport in, and he wanted to donate it to the district, and so he would like it to have priority list for Midland High golf team, but we explained to him we can do that, but once it becomes a district vehicle, we'll also open it up to other options. He was very open to doing that. So we'll have a little bit of a priority list where it leans to Midland High golf team or Midland High teams, and then eventually, if it's not used, it can be used for other small teams as well. So maybe it'll get the other side of town going, we'll get another van donated.
Don't look at me, Mike.
We've been doing a lot of tours over there at Central Park, and it's growing, the amount of people that want to see it. So as Brad said, I think it's a very unique facility. We built a very unique facility, and now we got to deliver the change of instruction that we're doing there. So we think we got a great teaching staff ready. They're the early adapters, the risk takers ready to go there. Lots of good ideas, and I think we're up to the challenge. But certainly the challenge really happens after we get that building open and get the people in there to see if we can change that side of it. And you probably have noticed that schools have had the flu bug going through, and some have had low enough where they've had to close. I've watched that very closely, and I sent something out to our community. At our lowest point, our two high schools hit 85%. A week later, we had Northeast get the flu bug, and they hit 85%. That's been our lowest, and we've been in 91 and 96%. So are we seeing more? Yes. Are we seeing large enough that we need to close? No. Have we done deeper cleaning, which means cleaning services with a stronger cleaning product? We have, and so we'll continue to do that, which causes us to add some more hours and manpower to do that. But we've done that in each building, and again, we've kind of encouraged parents to, if they see those signs, keep them home. It's not often we want to keep them home, but on this one, we probably do. Yeah. And we need to take care of that piece as well. And that's all I have for you tonight.
Okay. All right. Yes, that is a very good point. My daughter said it wasn't the kids who were homesick. It was the ones who were at school sick that were probably the ones that were helping to spread it. So, all right. And with that, we will end the board meeting. Thank you.